Can everybody hear me? Yes. So my talk will be not on plants, but on A20 and obesity, and hopefully some new insights on immunometabolism. So as you all know, oh, it shifted the PowerPoint, but yeah. I'll just wing it. As you all know, we are constantly evolving, and we've already evolved a long way, but it seems like we are evolving into this chubby little fellow here. So it's been even in the and in this talk, I would like to give you some new insights on how to stay lean. So it's been in the news actually this week that obesity is becoming a major health problem in Western countries. Like in Europe, over 50% of the people are obese and overweight, and 1 in 3 children in Europe are obese or overweight. But why is obesity so bad? It's actually because it leads to a bunch of secondary diseases which are clustered in the metabolic syndrome. For example, fatty liver disease, which can eventually cause liver cancer, cardiovascular disease, type 2 diabetes. All these things have a major impact on the health system. But the basis of all these diseases is actually quite the same. The problem is that the metabolic tissues are in a low-grade inflammatory state. And with metabolic tissues, I mean the liver, fat tissue, etc. And I will focus on fat tissue, especially visceral fat tissue, which is the fat in your belly, let's say. Okay, this is going completely wrong. As you can see, all my slides are a bit messed up. Let's focus on this part for a second. In lean adipose tissue, you have several immune cells that are present. And I will focus on macrophages. Macrophages are actually the cleanup crew of your body. So they scavenge your body looking for stuff to eat, like dead cells, bacteria, viruses, etc. And so in a lean person, in steady state, these macrophages just look around in your fat tissue looking for dead adipocytes, which they can eat up and in this way maintain the normal functioning of your tissues. So in a lean state, these macrophages are in an anti-inflammatory state. So it's a sort of subtype of your macrophage, and they also call this an M2 macrophage. Now, upon obesity, a lot changes. So your adipocytes are they have to take up a lot of fat. So they have to store it, and they are stressed by this. So they will die, and this will lead to the recruitation of additional macrophages and a lot of other immune cells, but I will focus on the macrophages. And they will come and clean up all these dead adipocytes. But the problem is that there's also a lot of free-flowing fatty acids, glucose, and all these things turn the situation into a pro-inflammatory state. And so also your macrophages change into a pro-inflammatory subtype. And this will make everything worse because this will lead to insulin resistance, to more adipocytes dying. And the problem is also that obesity is usually a chronic disease, so it just keeps on going on and going on. And so I will focus on the switching between the anti-inflammatory macrophage and the pro-inflammatory macrophage. And what is important in so what determines the outcome of this macrophage of being an M2 or an M1 is which receptors are being activated, and transcription factors play an important role in this. And NF-kappa B signaling is also very important in the pro-inflammatory response. So it's a transcription factor that is activated when its receptor is being stimulated, for example, by LPS. It will go to the nucleus, and it will induce a transcription profile with a lot of pro-inflammatory cytokines like TNF, IL-6, IL-1, which are all associated with obesity. Now, this is a very important transcription pathway, so it is also heavily regulated. So it induces negative feedback regulators like A20 to really make sure that this does not go in overdrive, to contain the inflammatory response to a normal homeostatic way. And so A20 is my favorite protein to work on, and this is also what this talk is about. So A20 will stop and terminate NF-kappa-B signaling by changing the ubiquitination status of several upstream mediators. And the goal of my project was to investigate the role of A20 in this M1, M2 macrophage polarization in the context of obesity. So we generated a conditional knockout mice, which doesn't have A20 in macrophages, and we put this mice on a high-fat diet to induce obesity. And our hypothesis was that we would drive these macrophages into more pro-inflammatory response, as NF-kappa-B is not being terminated and it can just go on producing cytokines. However, we saw the complete opposite. So these mice, they didn't get fat, and they had a lot of M2 macrophages present. So now some results. As you can see, their body weight, so this is the knockout mice on high-fat diet, behaves like a normal mouse, so it doesn't gain any weight at all. Also, cholesterol and triglyceride levels do not increase. When you look at their visceral adipose tissue, which is shown here, you can see that it's a lot smaller in weight. Also, their subcutaneous adipose tissue is reduced. And we quantified the size of these adipocytes and the number of adipocytes, and you can see that it's more the size that is reduced unless and not the number that is reduced. You can also clearly see here in the wild-type condition that you have these crown-like structures, which are macrophages surrounding a dead adipocyte trying to eat it. And in the knockout situation, this is not really present. The macrophages are more in between all the adipocytes. They are also completely protected from type 2 diabetes, as their hyperglycemia is milder. There is no hyperinsulinemia and no hyperleptemia. When you inject glucose, you can see that the knockout can quickly get these glucose levels back to normal with a minimum amount of insulin, while a fat mouse is not able to do this and needs a lot more insulin to achieve a reduction in glucose levels. When you inject insulin into these mice, the knockout mice also behave normally, as you would expect from a lean mouse, so glucose levels quickly go down because tissues are being stimulated to take up glucose, while a high-fat diet wild-type mice, so a fat mouse, is not able to do this as efficiently. So what is going on in the fat of these mice? Surprisingly, we saw more macrophages present in the knockout situation. Also, more monocytes, which is the progenitor of a macrophage. So this indicates that monocytes come in from the blood to the fat tissue and then differentiate into a macrophage. And when you look at the M2, M1-like phenotype of these macrophages, you can see, maybe I'll explain it first. So this is the M1-like macrophage, and these are the M2-like macrophages. As you can see, standard diet wild type has a lot of M2-like macrophages, while in high-fat diet wild type, it shifts to more M1-like macrophages. And in the knockout situation, you have a lot of M2-like macrophages, which we also quantified, and you can see here. However, when you look at their expression profile, they seem to have still a very pro-inflammatory cytokine expression profile, as all these cytokines are NF-kappa-B driven, so they are still highly upregulated, which is quite confusing. So it seems like they have both characteristics of M1 and M2-like macrophages, and that somehow something makes them not get fat, the mice. What we also saw is when you do qPCR on the fat tissue is that some genes of mitochondrial biogenesis are upregulated, like PGC1-alpha and NRF1, in the knockout, indicating that there might be something going on with their mitochondrial biogenesis and metabolism. So to conclude, we think that the macrophages deficient of A20 produce more NF-kappa B response genes as the regulator is not present. However, we also see characteristics of M2-like macrophages, like their surface receptors. So we think that these macrophages are somewhere in between M1 and M2 macrophages. And it's known that M2 macrophages have a different metabolism than M1-like macrophages, as they are very more efficient in metabolizing free fatty acids. So we think these macrophages also have a higher metabolism, as you could see by their mitochondrial biogenesis genes, and that this might metabolize all the free fatty acids present in the high-fat diet. And that this is the cause that these mice do not get fat and don't develop type 2 diabetes. So hopefully, if we investigate this further, we can find new insights on how inflammation and metabolism regulate each other and how A20 is involved. Otherwise, I think our future will look quite gloomy. With this, I would like to thank you for listening and my awesome lab for helping me, and also Hert and Charlie for the help with the fox. Thank you.
Thank you very much. One question. You are very quiet today.